Yes, can
I'm
imagine.
ready. I'm sure you're ready too. So, can you just
Yes.
introduce yourself quickly, just so people who are here who don't know you, just so they have an idea of what you do? And obviously, we
Yes.
haven't met yet, but when we talked to Nick, he told me a lot of good things about what you do, what you did with Italy junior national team, and the work that you do with now with the youth teams in Monaco, right?
Yes. Yes. I have a can you give me the possibility to share my screen?
Yes.
So
Yes, 1 second. Yep, now you should be good.
okay, because I have the in my presentation, I put something about myself because when you do something outside of your country, people don't know you probably. So, guys, before start, first of all, you can interrupt me in every moment. So to ask questions, to stop me for everything you need, and also in general. I think that if we share ideas and we have like a basketball talk is the best way to use this time the best we can together, no? Click quick
Right.
introduction about myself. I'm a professional coach. I was a I'm a professional coach that started my I started my career in Italy. I was in a top female club that was Basket Parma. I was a young coach in my city, Parma. And Parma was a club with a lot of tradition with the youth, and they give me a lot of idea. I had a lot of mentors in this club because I think that Cinzia Cooper, she's the Michael Jordan of female basketball, was there. So for me, it was a great opportunity to stay in a club and learn. And then I was lucky because I was selected by Monte Paschi Siena. There was one of the best clubs in Europe 10 years ago. I was a young guy, and I had the possibility to stay with the amazing player and amazing coaches. And then I start to be more and more important in Stella Azzurra, that now is considered one of the best youth clubs in Europe. Stella Azzurra is used to, they beat also Real Madrid in under 18 tournament. They are used to go to EuroLeague finals of youth. So it was great opportunity for me to be one of the main coaches there. And then I was the youth coordinator of Trieste, where I built my program with my ideas. So in 4 years I improved this youth club in everything from recruitment to coaching the coaches, increasing the work with all the city, increasing the numbers of people playing basketball, so everything. And now I'm consultant of youth in Monaco, and also I work individually with the best players of the youth, but also the best some players of the senior team. From 5 years old, I work in national team as assistant before, and now I'm head coach of under 15 of Italy. And then I work with Nike, Jordan Brand, and junior NBA events. All of this is what I did, but what I think is more important is why I coach. You can see this was me 10 years ago in Siena with two normal kids, and this is me last summer in the national team with the selected team. But my point is always the same. I think this is very important to increase our level of coaching, is to know why we coach. And for me, my why is that I want to raise people. I want to people increase their level inside the court and outside the court. This is something that for me is normal. I'm coming from a basketball family, and my father was a professional soccer player. So in my family, sport is life. And that's why for me, be a coach is something that comes from the bottom of my heart. And I think this is something that is very important. We find why we coach. Because if our why is the money or having a better car, or I think it's not working. This is a result, and it's good. I mean, but the key is why we coach, because then when we have to make some decisions, we know, if we know our why, we have more possibility to take the right decision for ourselves and for the players. Why we talk about dynamic one-on-one and why this is important for me. I tell you the story of this, because when I was young, I was dreaming to have a team that sharing the ball, playing smart inside the court. And I was struggling with this. My team wasn't that good in this, and I wanted this, no? And then at the same time, I was in Tel Azzurra, so almost 8 years ago, I was used to do camps all around Italy, and I see all these players very good with the dribble, very good to making dribbles around cones, again zero. And then when we start to play, they weren't good players. And so I started to think about this, no? Why all these players, we coach them to dribble, and then when we go inside the court, they are not able to play good, no? And also, I wasn't satisfied about my team, my players. I have the feeling that we could do more. Then I studied a lot Ettore Messina, that is a great coach in Italy. Great coach, amazing coach. I am a big fan of him, and I was studying. I knew everything about him. And he was also the assistant coach of Greg Popovich, and he won everything in Europe. And then I was lucky because Messina talked a lot about this dynamic 101, the idea to play in motion. And I was lucky because one day in Stella Azzurra, one of his historic assistants come and visit us for 3 days. So I have the possibility to share, to put together my knowledge about the books with something real, because I saw one guy that was with him on the court. And then with a few rules, he teach me and some concept, my team completely changed. So my team really, that season, the players, they started to play completely different in a smarter way, with a better quality of fundamentals. And from that day, I understand how important it is to play dynamic. And then I was lucky because in national team, I had that coach we had is Andrea Capobianco and also Antonio Bocchino. I was his assistant. They developed a lot the idea of playing movement and play dynamic. And so then this make me become better in this. So going in practical things, what is dynamic 101 and what is static 101? I want to show you one video. Okay. I want to show one video to start to understand this difference. It's very important to really understand the topic we're talking about. The static 101 is this. So it's a situation where one guy has the ball, and this guy have to create using the dribble, and while all the other players are watching him, the advantage. So with the dribble, you create the advantage to shot. Can be like this, or can be, I stop because sometimes the video is going not good, so that's why I stop, guys. So creativity in this case wasn't good, but this is static 101. And this is dynamic 101. This is dynamic 101. So going back to the presentation, the difference is that static 101 is the situation when we have one player with the ball that have to create the advantage with the dribble while the others watch him play. In my ideas, I put a limit on this situation. And I don't think static 101 is something bad, because when you play post-up, when you play in a mismatch, for example, in pick and roll, the switch, you have a playmaker against a big man, in the last 8 seconds, on when the paint is free, so when the defense is completely aggressive to deny the pass lines, is a good moment to play dynamic one-on-one. But it's very important for me to put a limit in this situation. What is dynamic one-on-one? Dynamic one-on-one is the situation when moving the player and the players and moving the ball, we play with an advantage for the player with the ball inside the shot range. Which are the rules to play dynamic? Before I want to show you another video.
Mm-hmm.
This is dynamic 101 as a team, no? So moving the players and the ball, we just play with an advantage. So now Dio is working with his body and he sealed the defense, and now he just received the ball with an advantage inside his shot range where he can score. Then the defense double team him, and now West is ready for shot inside his shot range. And then he passed the ball with a player with that increased the advantage, and again Ginobili passed the ball. And now, at the end, moving the balls and the players, we have an easy shot. This is what we want. This is what we dream with our team.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. So this is what we dream. Another idea, Golden State, drive, ready for shot, moving the balls, everybody ready for shot. Moving the boss and the players, you saw, you just have an advantage. And the same is in a play. Now we have a play to put Draymond Green in post-up. And now, moving the players and the ball, we get the advantage. Again, we play with just the advantage inside the shot range. And moving the players and the ball, we have a shot or with high percentage. Going back to the rules, which are the rules of this? Because if you see these actions, okay, you see they move the balls, but how we can put rules in this movement of players and ball? First thing, all these players, they catch the ball, not looking only the passer, but every time they catch the ball, they recognize also the position of the defense while they get the ball. So before they get the ball, all these players using the peripheral vision, they are ready to make a decision. When they catch the ball, for example, in the closeout situation, and I'm ready for shot, and the defense is not in good balance, we attack hard the basket with the ball or without the ball with a cat. When you lose the time to take the shot, imagine the situation when before in the San Antonio Spurs situation, David West get the ball. If you are not able to make the shot because you lose the time or you are not inside your shot range, you pass the ball to a teammate that is at a better position. These are the three rules. And if you think about the action we saw, you see these three types of situation. There is a shot or a drive. There is a cut or is a deep seal. These are the situation where we can play dynamic on the court. Why I work dynamic 101 with my team? Because if my players know how to play, how you seen the video before, they know how to play modern basketball. Modern basketball is dynamic. It's not one guy that dribble. So you can have James Harden in your team, but James Harden, when he was the national team of USA, he can play dynamic. So then he's a strategic choice of his coach and of himself to play static. But I hope you have James Harden in your teams. I don't have James Harden. I hope to create four guys that can play with James Harden. So I have to create players that can play also without the ball. If they can play with this concept, they can play not my system, but every system. If we don't teach this rule to the youth players, they play ours. So before my system, there are the rules to play smart basketball. If my team's playing this way, they increase their IQ. Because like in the first rule of Dynamic 101, while they get the ball, they have to see also the defense. Not only my teammate to pass me the ball and then to create the advantage with the dribble. I have to recognize also the defense. So I have to have a good IQ. I have to be able to pass, to play with these ideas. And then I have to play 0.5, like Spurs. So I have 0.5 seconds to make a decision. And this way of play creates problem to the defense. That's why we all love the way of San Antonio Spurs play, because for the defense is really hard to play against this type of offense. And then I develop inside and outside game of my players. So I create a modern player that can play outside and inside. Let's go to the drills. Another thing I want to add, just to be clear. During the years, I work to create this. So I work to create players very good in play without the ball. And for me, it's a process. You start with the player and the ball when the player is young, and this is the basement, and then you play without the ball, and then you are able to play with screen. And this is all the drills you will see, they are part of the team concept, but I'm a big fan of individual workout. You see the picture, this is me working when the gym is closed with my player. Because then there is the player and the ball. There is the ability to score and to create with dribble, different type of finishing, different type of shot. And then when they become older, game situations. So from one side, there is the team and there is make them be modern players and be able to share the ball. But from the other side, guys, there is the player and the ball. So team is pass. Individual workout is score. And this is something crucial. Without working both, for me, there's no quality create a modern basketball player. I share the drills I use to create this, especially with the team. This is an old drill. This is an old drill where I teach to the players to see of the passer, but also the defender. Now we simulate a flat defense close to us, not far. And so we have to be able to read the space and to cut in front. And then for this drill, then you work on the technique. You work in the technique of pass. You work on, for example, now I correct this guy. There are clinics. I use clinics images, not my team, but then you teach them, for example, here you have to pass straight to the defense to get the ball. You teach finishes, you teach basketball, okay? But you teach in a dynamic way, in the real situation of playing without the ball. Then different. Before you see the pass, now the defense is in the middle between you and the pass. So in this situation, you have to be able to do a backdoor cut. So in this situation before, you don't play for get the ball and then to create the advantage with the dribble, but you get the ball in the correct position considering the defense to score. Also, details. So now I work on how I don't want 2 feet on the ground, but I want 1 foot to push, the other give the direction, and my shoulder are square to the basket that they have to stay low. So then while you do these drills, you have to work on the details. Same in the pass. The pass is before the help. It's a bounce pass before the help. You can work on dribble and pass, and then other details. While you pass the ball, able to run and immediately play. Then dynamic drive. So I get the ball, I see there is a space because the defense is flat, so I get the ball in front of him. Why have to get the ball here then to create the advantage with the dribble? I get the ball in front of him, and then details, feet down the ball, shoulders go to the basket, and feet go to the basket. And then also I work in the timing of the pass. Why, when they have to pass the ball, where they have to pass the ball. Now I correct this with the guys. So what's the target? Imagine you are in front of the defense, or pass the ball forward. Then same situation, same idea, different situation. The defense, the die going out of balance. And so I attack straight to the basket. I stay low, I push. And then in Europe, we have the zero step. So we have 0, 1, 2. And my shoulder are forward. And I teach also how to use the rules in these drills. And then same idea. I don't play only for get the ball, but I play with the idea that while I get the ball, I recognize before the advantage. So if the defense is inside the paint, I'm ready to shot. I don't need to have a triple threat. Triple threat, you don't need triple threat. You need to read before to get the ball what is happening. You need triple threat when you don't have advantage. But if you have the advantage in the defensive far, you have to sprint, stay low, get the ball, and be ready to shot. Now that guys going close to the defense because they are 12 years old. If there are older player, they can go a bit far. And then I use the coach that knows the players, that knows what they can do and what they cannot do. So the coach can work on the things that we want them to do. For example, a guy that don't want to shot, I make him shot every day in the practice. And then I build the ideas and then I start to work one-on-one. I make a one-on-one when the defense have to make, the offense have to make decisions considering the defense. So now I give this advantage. So I work in the dynamic driving to catch and go directly to the basket, but I give also the possibility to cut. So if the offense catch the ball, the defense have to give high five to the coach. Okay, like this. But if the offense see that there is advantage, the offense can make another decision. So like cut. And then also the coach can do in this way. So create a possibility to this player to shot or drive. Again, he recognizes the position of the defense and he makes a decision not to get the ball, but to cut. So with the easy basket, they start to understand that if they watch not only the ball, but one eye to the defense, they can be smart and make easy baskets.
I got a question while you're still drinking the water. Yes. So who decides if the offensive player cuts? Is it on you or on the player?
Not the player.
Okay.
So yes, he has the, he's like in the game. I use this deal because I want him to make decisions considering the position of the defense. This is the key, no?
Okay.
Also of a smart offense. If you make decision watching also the defense, not only the ball, to receive the ball, because the goal is not to receive the ball, but is to receive the ball with the biggest advantage I can have to score.
Mm-hmm.
Okay? Tell me if there are other questions in the chat. I can stop, and it's great. Thank you for the question, so I can be more more precise in the explanation.
Mm-hmm. As of now, simply amazing. And I agree. That's a good idea.
Thank you. Any question then, other or no, I can go.
No, you can go.
Okay. Ah, senti, ok, so, another action, no? Because we have to see from the game what we need, not to think, is the game that gives us the solutions and the play, the high-level players. So, Golden State plays. So, he is ready for shot. Remember the rule. If the defense goes out of balance, you attack at the basket. And this is what Thompson's do. And now he's doing this without the ball, with a cut. And then he shared the ball. And now again, close out situation. You remember before is seal, cut, and shot or drive. If a player can do these three simple things, we have a high level player. And all the details on this, he can be the best player for his level. And now he's ready to shot, reading the close-up, score. So be able to make also this shot. Then we are in a pre-season situation, pass the ball, swing, also Harden, read the defense is close, and he get the ball with a small advantage. Now we create he play the pick and roll with an advantage. The roll, again, is ready for score, but the defense is coming, and he pass the ball to a teammate to a better advantage, that pass the ball again to a team that to increase the advantage. And now this player read that he has to drive while he gets the ball. So he recognized the advantage before, and now playing the big man playing in the back of the defense, he had an easy basket. So from these ideas, then another one-on-one situation. Big advantage, defense. The defense can pass the ball to one guy or the other, and if he passes the ball to this guy, the other guy is in offense. So he passed the ball, and now is the moment. We have to teach to the player that in this time, we have the possibility to have a big advantage. And so the guy is ready to score, but the defense is out of balance. And so we attack at the basket. Same situation. While the ball is moving, the guy sprint to stay with the advantage, and he's ready to shot, and he make an easy basket. This is the goal. But in reality, what they do, our players, they do this. Here is a typical situation of a big advantage, of an extra pass, when we just have the advantage, so we have only to score, only to beat the defense. Look now what our players do. The ball is here, and he still have to move. He makes fakes, V-cut, when we don't need a V-cut, and now he's happy because he got the ball. But now he has to create the advantage with the dribble. He's not James Harden, and so he make the best shot for the defense. A two contested shot, 23% in the games. 23% is the percent of this shot. Why this? Because he didn't play for score, but he play only for get the ball. Now another time, fakes, and now again, get the ball. And now I stop him and I correct. And I put a limit on this. Then one-on-one, similar, a bit different. Defense, offense, and the other player is in the other side, you don't see him. He passed the ball, and while he passed the ball, we have the advantage for this player. And so the player has to read where is the advantage. He cut in front. He cut in front, and he score. Now, it's different. Now this guy makes a lot of fakes. He get the ball, and now no advantage. So this is the key. While you get the ball, you have to recognize the defense is inside. I get the ball outside. The defense is up. I cut in the back. You see now? And then this is very important detail. When you work without the ball, 1 foot on the ground and the other just push in the other direction. If you put 2 feet on the ground, you, the defense, have the time to react. If 1 foot you stop and then you change direction with the feet that goes in the direction you want to go, you, the defense is late to react, like happened in this 101. Now it's the same. Dynamic driving, score. So this is the moment. Read. If the defense is down, I go up. If the defense is up, I go down. Then another situation. They move the ball. Now Draymond Green, he see before that there is a space to drive and he drive. No space to shot. Ready for shot. Increase the advantage. It's always the same. And now, reading the closeout. So we have to be able to create players that can make easy this shot. Attack and then simple. How we create a player that can make a shot with that defense that goes in front, that goes to play defense against him in a closeout. Simple, pass the ball, and then one dribble of decision, shoot or drive. Simple. And then they have to understand to take the decision considering the balance of the defense and the distance. If he's close, I drive. If he's far, if the defense is far, I drive. If the defense is far, I shut. This is static situation, then I can work dynamic. So pass the ball, the defense have to touch this line and the offense sprint in the other side. And then the coach pass the ball and then we have a perfect situation of closeout, but is a bit more difficult for offense that he has to make a decision moving before, not standing still like in the previous exercise. And this is a situation you can recognize when in the videos we saw before, when Curry drive past the ball and going out in the Europe, we call this a Georgievich move to get the ball again and be ready to play against the closeout. Then similar situation, be different. The defense is here, offense is here. When the defense run to give high five to the coach, the offense comes up to the wing position. There is the pass of the coach. The defense will be in late, and then we play again a closeout situation. But this you can recognize easy. This can be a pick and roll, like a drop situation. The roll goes. These guys make a late bump, and then he's coming back against the spawn that went out to get the pass. So these are closeout situations that the guys then have a lot of times in the game. Then watch this action. Same concept. So ready for shot or drive, attacking the closeout. Then the rule is, I give this rule to the players. Every time you can play 1-on-1 and you have advantage, play. But when you play 1-against-2, pass the ball. Again, close out. 1-against-2, pass the ball. Again, attacking the close, and then another key point. Is not always like we did in the exercise before, spacing outside. Is not always play for score. It doesn't mean play for shot 3-point. Sometimes there is a rule. If the defense don't look at you, cut in the back. So the Aleksandar Nikolic rule, the coach from Serbia, the father of European basketball, always said years and years ago, the defense never have eyes in the neck. So every time you see the neck of the defense, cut in his back. So how I create this concept. So now offense is driving, like we see before in the example of the game. We imagine the defense is inside, pass out, and then be ready for shot. Same, but now that in the defense we put our coach. And so if the coach stay, you shot. If the coach come and he goes out of balance, you attack the closeout and you drive. And this we are not, this is the principles inside every system. So this is something that for me is important to work when they're youth, when I have a senior team. This is basketball. And then same situation, but it's different, the help. If the defense of this guy collapses inside the paint, we stay, the space is outside. But if the defense, like in pack line defense, he makes a stand, or he fake to get the ball, in this moment, a lot of defense, they're not looking us. And so we can cut in the back. So when the defense, or like now a lot of teams help from the strong side, they push you in the middle and they want to help, like switch into, so they have less rotation. But if they do this and you are able to cut in the back, you always win. But you must be able as a player to recognize that now the space is in the back of the defense. And then now the coach is static, but the coach also can go back. And so instead of cut, they can do like before, to go on the 3-point line to make a shot. And then I put this in one-on-one situation. So now I have the control of the game. And if the defense comes here, like to steal the ball, the offense cut in the back. You see? Help.
Mm-hmm.
And then they play dynamic. If the help is inside the paint, the space is outside. And so they recognize the situation, and then we help them to do better decision on the court. Then, another time, same concept. Advantage, moving the ball and the players. Big advantage to shot, so extra pass. But now, again, defense is out of balance. So I'm ready to shot, but I pass and cut. So you saw this guy, he stay low and he's ready to react to attack the basket. And then the same concept, playing the back. This is very important for the defense. Don't have eyes in his neck. So in the back, you have space for score. So how I teach them to be ready from the pass to cut? Two balls drills. This guy have the ball. We one very, very good coach from Italy, Giordano Consolini, inventing this drill. I think it's great that you have two balls and can pass the ball. So you start to, first of all, to react immediately. Second thing, you start to see that if one door is closed, it's open the other. And usually I give to them no dribble. So they have to not to use dribble to get the advantage, because they have two balls, so they have a lot of advantage and they have to be able to recognize that. Now, pass the ball, and look what happened. This guy cuts, he knows that we have two balls, but he continue to look at this guy. So he don't see that the other guy is ready to pass the ball to him and he's ready to get the ball and score. So he's not looking the defender. Is only looking the ball to get the pass. This is the problem we have with the player. It's not about the pass. It's about to get the ball in the position to score easy. And now I stop him. He get the ball. And what happened now? He get the ball to create the advantage with the dribble. This is what the most of the player want. But now I show them that if here you don't have advantage, the advantage is on the other side. So I work on the cut, but I work also on the seal situation. And do you remember this? This was the first action I show you guys. What is doing the O? they create a triangle. So if the defense closed this door is open on the other side. And so then from this position, Isil and the other advantage. Then I want to show you one progression. Like this was my national team under 14. So I put all together now so you understand how I work with the U teams. So concept like before, again, zero, when we give to them the tools, the skills to do the right reading. So also now they play in two. So I get the ball, I work also on the pivoting, and then they have two, they shot, they cut in front. I give to them different reading. Ready for shot, cut, backdoor. I didn't put everything, but I give different solution again zero. Then we go 1-on-1. Now, defense is in front. And the rule is that when the defense moves, the defense can touch the 3-point line from this side on this side, and then the offense react. Why I do this? Because I want the offense to start to take decision considering the position of the defense. So if the defense move in this way, means that we have space in front. So we cut in front, we made a front cut, and we have space in front. If the same year, and the offense must stay low and ready to react. Because if you do this drill, the first time they are happy only to get the ball. They don't understand that if they cut in the right way, they can have a very bad shot from 1 millimeter from the basket. Okay? So, same concept. Now we give also the possibility that they can touch the 3-point line from both sides. And then we put a sign here. They can also decide the defense to touch this sign. And so we create also a situation to shot. So they can cut, or they can shot, or they can shot, or driving, attacking the closeout. Now, same as before, the defense decide to touch the 3-point line, so the offense must be ready to cut in front. And now the drill of before. So while the ball go, the offense must be able to play 1-on-1 dynamically. The video, you can see everything. They are working good or not?
They're a little bit slow, but that's when you're stopping. And then clicking into play, it looks.
It's better.
It's better.
Okay, so now same concept. Okay, like we did before. So pass the ball, defense, offense, get the ball, and then play with just an advantage to score. With the idea, and then we play 2-on-2. So we have the same 1-on-1 of before, but with the possibility, like in the first 2-0 you saw in this progression, to play also with the other side. So now the guy is denying, so he cut the backdoor, and so the other guy is coming up. So we have this 1-on-1 and this 1-on-1. This guy recognizes that he has no space, so he tries to get outside to get the ball, and he clear out for the backdoor on the other player. And then I put all together 3-on-3. So same situation of 2-on-2 on this side. And on the side close to the coach, we have a extra pass and closeout situation. So if I pass the ball to this guy, the guy in the corner, we can have a shoot or drive situation. If I pass the ball like now in the middle, we have the situation of before. And so now they are free to play without the ball. Now we have advantage with the backdoor cut, but we don't finish in the right way. They continue to play. Didn't stop the ball, so ready to shot. And now what happened? He drives, he helped, he see the space in the back, he moved, and he has an easy shot. So, Any question now?
From me now, I'm ready to keep you going. But if people have questions, feel free to ask in the comment section,
yes,
and we'll go right away.
Then, I talk a lot about Dynamic 101. We have to have a balance, because when I started to understand the importance of Dynamic 101, then I did maybe too much of Dynamic 101. Because at one point, if they learn how to play with the cats, with the ready for shot drive, then they lose a bit of attacking the basket with the dream ball. So I think it's very important to have a good balance between static 101 and dynamic 101. Because my goal is not to be beautiful for the people that watch my game and they see, oh, they pass the ball a lot, they make this backdoor cut. No, I rather to have a team that maybe is not perfect in terms of spacing, especially when they are young, but I want everybody to play one-on-one with the ball and without the ball. So I wanted my team play 5 one-on-one at the same time. So maybe sometimes I can have a bit of confusion because it's hard to be aggressive and not to stay in the route of the play. But I prefer to have players that then recognize space, recognize advantage, and they are ready every time to attack with the ball and without the ball. And this, I create this with this balance of one-on-one with the ball and one-on-one without the ball.
Mm-hmm.
How I create this? How I create this balance? This balance, let's go back to the first drill, okay? Now imagine this drill is a bit different because this guy is coming with the dribble. And this guy is making the same. So he read the space and he get the ball, watching the position of the defense, in this case, the coach, and makes a dynamic driving. And now, for example, we work also on finishing. So now we work also on floaters. So now the coach is denying. So you see the coach lose the balance, and so I drive and then floater again. Just to give you guys examples. So the key is that when this guy is not going to drive, but he look at you, is the signal not to space, but to play for get the ball. And for score, and then for score, in this case, cutting. So read the defense, cut, and then finish. So you see that they have a good timing. So when this guy look, he start to play. Because if this guy drive, he have to space, not to play for get the ball. Any question? I saw there is maybe on the chat something.
Mm-hmm. Can you please list the rules for those plays, which in your opinion are in every organization or system? Once again, I didn't got them all.
The rules are very simple. The rules are that every time you get the ball, that you don't have to look only to the ball, but you have to have one eye to the defense. And if you see this, you can see the rules you can have in these drills. So first rule is that you have to, now they play forget the ball, but they have to look the coach. The coach is the defense, because the coach gives different reading. For example, the coach now is flat, so the best thing is to get the ball a bit in front of him so you can drive in directly and have advantage and beat him. Now the coach is denying. So while they get the ball, they have to have one eye to the ball and one eye to the defense. And they have to see that, for example, now he's denying. We imagined that he goes out of balance and so he has to drive. Second rule, like in this situation, if you go out of balance, is that when the defense goes out of balance, you have to hard attack the basket. And the last rule is that when a player lose the rhythm or lose the balance, you have to pass the ball to a teammate that have a better advantage than yours. So if you lose the advantage, you have to pass the ball, not to dribble and then to create. Okay. Is it clear or not, guys? Mm-hmm.
Yep. For me, yeah. For me, it's clear.
Okay. So now, same drill, but we work on the on the cut situation. So like before we work on the shot, on the driving, and now we work on the shot or drive watching the coach, okay? If the guys go out of balance, I drive. So this is everything you saw before in the game situation. And then now the coach gives all the reads. So now the coach, you saw, the coach is far, I shot. The coach decide. The coach go out of balance, I drive. So this is similar to what we did before, but now you understand how I create the balance between playing without the ball and driving. This is the key. Now is the same situation. So the guy is coming dribble. There is another player on the other side. And then there is a guy in the weak side. Now the player drives. So the difference is that this player don't have to play for get the ball in the middle. But he start to recognize the difference between driving and playing together for the pass. And then he see the difference when I have to space and I have to play for get the ball because the team need to do this. And I want team also to be aggressive. So I teach them also to attack to the basket, not only to play for the pass, because then become too many passes. We want to score. We want to be aggressive. And then what I have in this drill, I make this guy drive and make a pass to the guy that spacing like a lot of action you see before in the back of the defense. And then I give the second ball, the coach gives the second ball to the guy that is outside, that drive, and we continue to play like Stephen Curry in the dribble before, and we are ready for shot because we have to coach them to make them make a lot of this situation because at the end, they have to be able to score when they have a pass from a drive. Same situation, drive, spacing, pass inside, pass out, balance, pass out again. And then look this, I want them, you saw them, I want them to play for offensive rebound every time. So, and then I put all together. The guy drive, and now the guy pass the ball. So the guy refused to drive and he look the teammates. So the teammate come to get this pass. And the other guy, now we have a three guy outside, spacing at the corner. Why? Because now the guy drive and he has to recognize the position of the coach. If the coach going like a pack defense to help high, the space in the back. So I have a ghost cut. And then look, this guy is ready to play for defensive rebound. Now different, I'm inside, so the space is outside. So you see the guy didn't cut in the back, but he stays outside because he has more space. So he's ready to shut. And then again, ready to play for the rebound. Then, how I create this mentality? How I want them to also to have situation when they drive. So this is the 0.5 Spurs drill. So drive, stop, pass out. Then again, drive, stop, pass out, which is the rule. When the coach says shut, you have to shut. So what create this rule? That every time you get this pass, you are ready for score. We want them not to get ready, then not to get the ball and then see. We want them every time ready for score. This is what you saw in the previous video. And if I say shot, they shot. If I don't say shot, they are ready for shot. They don't hear shot, and so they drive. So no other things, shot or drive. Make a decision. Sorry, and then you see, so drive, and then continue. So drive, replacement, like we saw in the drill before, pass out, and now I say shot, and so the guy shot. Then, these are drills against zero. How then I create these in small side game situation? So this is the guy. So okay, let's say a 2-on-2. This guy doesn't play. So we have 1-on-1, 1-on-1, okay? Red is offense and blue is defense. So, or like this. They play 1-on-1. So what it means? That if this guy beat the defense, he drives, okay? He helps, he play in the back like we want, and he play for score, he score. So they, simple. And then they learn how to space. So, and if I drive in the middle, for example, this guy help, and then I have to read if I have to stay in this position to get this pass. Or if the help is like this, if I have to move in this way to get this pass and score. But what happened? What we have to do if I try to drive and the defense stay in front of me? I have to play for create a pass. So I don't play for spacing. So I run out, maybe here. They are free to do. It's about reading. It's not about rules. And then he played the ball for shot or drive. I pass the ball and I'm ready to cut maybe to have a basket. Or if I pass the ball and immediately drive, this guy immediately drives, I have to space. I have to space. So they learn, I with my correction, I make them understand when they have to drive and when they have to play for a pass, and when they have to space, or when they have to be ready to cut. It's about correction, no? Because we worked before against zero, and now we put them in game situation. Same if these guys maybe start in this position. So from 2 against 2, same. It's the same like the drill against zero. He cannot beat the defense. So I have to play without the ball. Boom, sprint, to have this pass, and then to see. I can shot, he can come, I can drive, okay? He don't have space, so I cut. He have space to drive, he drive, I space out. Same situation, but different reading. If I can drive, so I can drive, I beat my the defense, so the guy help out, so there is space to cut, I cut. Easy basket, dunk. The cut, the guy help inside, high space outside, inside my shot range. So I give to them all these reading, and then they can play 3 against 3, same. So, because the key is that this guy, I push him to beat this guy. So, because from the, I want them to be able to cut, to drive, to pass, but I want them to be aggressive with the ball. So is it a static 1-on-1? Yes, it is. It is. I want them to play static 1-on-1 and to be aggressive, especially in the drills when we have a lot of space. And then from this static 1-on-1, then we go to the situation of dynamic 1-on-1 when they read the defense. Same 3 against 3. He beat, help, he space, help the helper, space is outside. The help is late. Maybe the center goes here. He follow him. He can cut in the back. And so we have this situation. So everything, then I correct. Okay, any question about this?
Yes, I have one, Alessandro. Yes. When would you go from static to dynamic? What would be the indicator for you? For example, you go static and you see, okay, now we can progress to dynamic, or you're thinking, oh no, not dynamic yet.
Yeah, this is a great point. This is a great question, and I thank you for the question, because this is the real difficult thing. Because, for example, I give you a practical example. Two years ago, I had an under-16 team, completely new. And so when you have a new team with a lot of new guys, it's very difficult that they have the ideas to share the ball, to play dynamic, to play with cut. They only dribble, or they're able to play with set, but no reading. And so I start always with the cats, with giving them the idea to share the ball. And so I worked for 4 months, and was the team of the day you will see the drill of the, how they play at the end. But when at that one point, at the half of the year, we start to play a lot with the pass, and was very good. But when we went to another level, so the team that we play against were a bit better, we start to have hard time. And they say, why? We play so good. We pass the ball. We share the ball. We cut. Why? Because we weren't aggressive with the ball, because you want to play dynamic, but you cannot always play dynamic, because sometimes the defense is good, or sometimes you don't have, maybe you don't have the possibility, because so maybe you need then, okay, now we need to create something from the dribble. So what I did, I create the drill you saw before, that I start with one guy with the ball that have to attack. So I went opposite in my system. So I started say to them, if you play without advantage, it's turnover, ball to the defense. And I finish say, if you don't play aggressive and you don't attack, turnover. So then they start to learn. Because at the end, the key is that the player start to make decisions. So it's not my rule. Mm-hmm. I give to them, I make them become good in both, and then they decide the situation by their own. It's not so my rule. My rule makes sense when I have to teach, but then I have to create a player that is able in the game to make decisions and to make plays, so to make scores, to be effective. Because someone can be better without the ball. Someone can be better with the ball. And maybe have also to improve his play without the ball. But maybe in the game, I cannot say to him, don't do it. Because maybe he's good in this. So it's a balance. I think it's about us. We have to be able to see, recognize, correct, and make decisions in our program. Considering every player and the level of the team, and yes, this I think I don't know if I answered to your question properly.
Yeah. Yep, you did.
Okay.
As of now, I don't see any questions yet. So it's up to you. Okay. Up to you to finish.
Yes, I go forward, and then I wanted guys to show with you and tell me, Buzz, if you cannot see properly, game situation. So this is the team we're talking before at the end of the season. So we play high level. This was Trieste against Treviso. So two very good team with recruitment. And we play, you see, he play aggressive to the basket and he play a floater. Again, this guy play aggressive. You see this? Cut in the back. Cut in the back and easy basket. Move the ball and the players playing just with advantage. So this guy get the ball with an advantage to shot. And you see the guys of out of balance. He drive and again floater against a big. And this guy, you can see from his body, is a average player. But if he know how to shot, if he has a credibility on shot, if he's able to drive in the closet, if he's able to get a floater, he can play. He can play against a team, a good team. So now this is static 101. So this individual workout, and then again, floater. So again, driving, cutting the back, easy basket. And this was a ton, drive, pass out, extra pass. And this is very important. Ready to shut. All the closeout drills. Ready to shut or drive. Again, driving, cutting the back in fast break, score. Inside one situation, attack. Static 101. Moving the ball and the players. Moving the ball and the players, attack, and then find a solution. Driving, pass out, ready for shot. Driving, balance, like we saw in the drill of 2 against 0, pass out, again, shot, ready.
Mm-hmm.
You saw the guys, they are not thinking. They shot or drive.
Yeah.
Move the ball and the players, driving without thinking, playing the back, extra pass. You saw this pass? He just passed.
Mm-hmm.
And this guy is ready for shot. Again, same game, another threes. And the opposite team was the first team of the league. Yeah? Wasn't a bad team. Was the best. This team, I guess, is the best team of the league.
Mm-hmm.
Again, moving the players and the ball, dynamic driving. And now look, ready for shot, out of balance, driving, and one step to finish. Again, moving the play. This is basketball. No, it's not a play. It's principles, no? They move the ball. The guys mm-hmm. see the defense is far. Always ready for the. We need players that are able to make a shot. Again, pass without team. Get the ball, drive. Pass out again. You saw ready for shot always. Shot or drive.
Mm-hmm.
Like in the NBA videos we see. Swing the ball fast. And again, a shot. Extra pass without. You saw the fast they pass the ball because they see the defense, and then you see the playmaker getting in the offensive rebound, like in the drill before.
Mm-hmm.
Static 101. Driving. And again, shot. So this is a mix of static, dynamic, and individual workout. And then this is another lab. This is, you saw under 16, but you see under 18. So it's almost a senior team. So you see playing with the plays, no? So moving the ball and the play. And then we have dynamic drive. Fake.
Mm-hmm.
Driving. Pass out. Reading the closeout. Shot. This is the same action we saw in NBA. The level is different, but the reading are the mm-hmm. same. Then we want post up as a static 101. And again, ready to drive and get a fall. Dynamic driving, attacking the ball, the basket. So without lose time to read, they read before. This is a situation you saw in the drill before. The defense mm-hmm. is out of balance. Defense. No, sorry. This is exactly the drill we saw before. Oh, no, this is okay. This is the dynamic driving, okay? And then we move the ball, move. He sees the defense is out of balance, trying to deny, and he drives. And then he gets the fall. And then look, post up. Defense don't have eyes in the neck. And so we cut in the back. Easy basket. This was the game. If we lost, we are out. And we won against a very good team. It's always the Treviso. cut front, we saw in the first drill. We saw this in the first drill of under 12. Cut in front, no eyes in the back. Cut in the back. And finish with the contact. And then the last, for me, is the most important. Every time ready, one or one, but one against two, we pass the ball, and then we are ready to shut. We are ready to shut. Again, ready to shut. This is these are my ideas. Any mm-hmm. question, any everything, guys, also the other topics, whatever you want, I'm here.
Mm-hmm. I love the idea because before I want to say that I did similarly when working on one-on-one with the players, both dynamic and static, but I didn't separate them that way. So I was doing the same when we talk about shooting, finishing, dribbling. I would go the same principle, dynamic to status. I mean, static to dynamic. When we were doing ones, I would just think of different ways how I can put one-on-one situation where it will be in games, but you giving it static to dynamic, it just, that's a great point to me.
Thank you.
And so we got Johan, he's from Colombia.
Yes,
he's coaching there. First of all, I appreciate your time and knowledge shared. I'd love to have those drill videos as well, but depends of you guys. Yeah, we'll figure it out.
I give you my email. So, and then they can find me on Instagram, so they can ask me everything. A lot of guys are asking me advice.
Okay.
So they can find me, and I'm open to discuss about everything, and also to share the video without problem.
Mm-hmm. So the you have zero step in the beginning. So how do you incorporate zero step in these situations, dynamic one-on-one?
I want to show you better than very fast. In mm-hmm. the first drill,
yeah.
We did. I want in this now. Want to see if I find.
Yeah, in Belgium, yeah. Gym, right?
Yes. We did. Mm-hmm. So this is the back door. I think was okay. This zero. Okay, this is the zero step, no? So when we have this situation, zero, one, so zero, and the rule is the same: never 2 feet on the ground. Zero, one to get space, two to attack, and then it's the same on the curl. On the curl, in the curl situation, I give the idea to play in running. So if you do 3 steps is good, if you do 2 steps is good. I think it's something you cannot control. So I teach to them how to use the zero step, but I don't force them to do zero step because it's something that is not so natural for them. So I just give them the possibility to try this. So I make them try also this, but I don't give to them, you must do zero step because you cover more space. But I put them in curl situation, in drive situation from the, when they want to deny and they lose the balance, these are the two best situations for me.
Mm-hmm. Got it.
Thank you, Emma.
Ilya, can you send your question again, please? Because my Zoom turned off and on again, so I don't see the question. I know there was one, but while he's, yeah, can you see it?
Which question? In your opinion, okay, yes.
It's from,
yes, I see. Yeah. Yes, for oh, yeah. In your opinion, do you think that the youth players need to push to this situation when they drive to the basket? If the pain is crowded because we need to teach to teach him finishing strong to the basket through the contact? This is a good question, very good question. Because like this, I think there is a balance. For example, I have to teach them that when they play one against one is very good, but when they play one against two, I want a pass. But when you have a really good player, and you need also, and maybe he playing a level where he's the best, I allow this player sometimes to play one against five, because I want him to become very good. So I want him sometimes to try something, to leave him free, to play, and also maybe to want to dunk on people or to make difficult. But so if I have a player really talented, I have to understand that sometimes I can fake like I don't see that, and he can go to dunk on people, no? Or maybe to make a one against three. But these are a balance, because then if he does always this, then he becomes a stupid player, because then when he will go to a higher level and he don't recognize that there are three people and the paint is crowded and he don't pass the ball, the coach will not like this, the senior coach. Uh-huh. So maybe he will go on the bench for this, or maybe he don't have mini time because the coach will not trust him. Or maybe he lose the credibility of the other players of the team, especially if he's not the best one. So I think it's important to have a balance us as a coach, and to understand which our goal with this player. And then I think this question is very good, because then we have to make them be able. There is one drill where I'm close to the basket, and I give like punches and I push the players so to make tough baskets, because I want them to play with the contact. I don't want to create like soft players. So I think we have to do both the situation, but then to have to work on that.
Okay.
Thank you. Great question. Very good question. Thank you.
Got it. Well, now I have my question, and I always ask that to coaches. It's off the topic. I wanted to talk particularly about the skills. If we take the floater, how do you teach it? Do you prefer players to hold the follow through or more of a push? What's your opinion on that?
When I teach, I say to the guys to make the floater like this, so without finish, because if you go to YouTube, and one day I did, and you watch the top 100 floaters in NBA, you see that nobody of them finishes the shot. Nobody. Okay, so you have like a slice. So in 100 shots, you see that everybody in NBA shot like this. It's more about the touch. It's not about the follow through. But for example, I had one very good playmaker, small. The team was very good in floater doing this. So we go back to, I think the coach makes the difference. I'm not for the rules. I'm about recognize what is the best for the body and for the player. Because maybe for some reasons, one player can be perfect doing like this. And if he shot perfect and the ball flip up and the floater is effective, if he shot like this, for me, it's okay. So usually I start in teaching like this, say to the players, feel the ball, use your touch. Don't do it technically, I say to them. Feel where you put the ball. And then I see what the player needs. Usually I started with the one step. I do the one step floater. Then I do Navarro shot. So like two step, La Bomba. So two step and then floater. Then I do the Iverson stop. So 2 feet down and the floater like this. Yeah, usually I use it. And then now I started to use floaters also in the different move. Like now you can have Euro step and then floater because maybe the big is coming. Or maybe you can have reverse and then floater. So reverse floater. So then I combine floaters to other movement. Or maybe you can have fake one step and floaters because now you, if you want to play high level, you have a big man of 2 meters and 10, they want to block you. So especially if you are a small guy, you have to know all the different way. I start this when they have 12 years old. So for me, that's why you saw in the video, one guy really not talented can make a perfect floater because we started this when he was 12, when he started working in my program in Trieste. I say to the coach that I wanted all this strange finish when they are young. And then I use like something big, like, I don't know, in English, something big to stop them. So then they play one against me, and I can stop them. So they have to find different way to the basket. This is usually the progression I use with the, and then one-on-one situation when they can decide if you floater or not. So I create a progression on floater. Basia, I lost you.
See, yeah, my wife. It would be. Hello, can you hear me?
Yes.
Would you do it with bigs too, or mostly guards?
I tell you this story. One day I did one clinic with four guards, and I show all these drills, no? And I was lucky because when I finished the clinic, the coach that had to do the clinic after me was Luca Banchi. That is an amazing coach. He is one of the best coaches in Italy we have. He's a genius. And I was lucky to work with him in Siena. And he's also a great person. And I said to him, Luca, what do you think about the clinic? And he said, this is very good for me. Because he makes me understand that all this is technique. And these drills can make really the big men become better and improve. Because if a big man can start to do the floaters, no, then he improves his touch. So maybe he will never use the floater in the game. But then when you have to make a baby hook, for him is a joke. Because baby hook compared to floaters from 4 meters, 3 meters, is a joke, no?
Mm-hmm.
It's easier. And I'm doing this now. So I think for the big man, we have to specialize them. But sometimes we have also to do something else. We connect them a lot.
Yeah, agree. A big with the touch, that's precious.
Yes.
But yeah, since there are no more questions, I was expecting some. I just wanted to say thank you for finding the time and thank you for a great presentation.
Thank you to you.
You already gave the contact information to the people so they can reach out too. Also, we'll save this webinar just so we can upload it to YouTube later, and either you can use it or the people who didn't have a chance to watch it, they can always go to YouTube and watch it later.
Good. Fantastic. Thank you. Thank you very much. It was a great time. Thank you to you and my friend Nicolas, and keep in touch. And you're doing a very good webinar involving all these coaches from all over the world. So guys, you're doing a great job, and I appreciate that.
Thanks. I saw Roberto tuning in at some point. So
yes, my man.
We'll be looking forward to see him talk.
Yes, he's the man, man. I teach him everything. You have to pay him.
Okay.
Say to him when he will, because maybe now he's doing some drills or something. I don't know if he's listening to us.
Okay. That's how I will start our conversation with him. Before I say anything, I'll say he has to pay.
Yeah, yeah, it's true, the story that you have to pay money to Alessandro because he teaches you a lot of things.
All right.
He's the man. Okay. Guys, thank you very much.
Have a good evening. And thank you, everyone.
You too, guys. Keep in touch. Bye-bye.